It's been a great 50 years for the family law section. I am proud to say I haven't been here for all 50 years, but I've been here for about 30 of it. And I think if you really want to enjoy your practice of family law and you really want to enjoy your life, get involved in section work. It's very rewarding. The people you'll meet, the friendships you'll make, and it will enrich your life in ways that you won't get if you just stay and go to your office at 7 o'clock in the morning and come home at 7 o'clock at night and do your thing. That's important work. It's important work. But the more important thing is to get out and to share your knowledge and be with people who have the same ideas you do. They deal with the same problems you do, and you'll have a much better life and practice if you do it. That's what I have done. I have been immensely rewarded for the work that I have been willingly and gladly done and the friendships I've made. It's just something that everybody ought to do. They owe it to themselves to do it for themselves, their family, their practice, and for the professionalism of being a lawyer and a family lawyer.
If you pass on that and you go out and you just practice on your own, that's fine, but you're just missing a chance to really have some great, great relationships. I've always said I learned more about practicing family law sitting in a bar drinking scotch with Bill Coons and Ken Fuller at the advanced course, them and a whole bunch of other people, than I ever did in law school or at the actual seminars. I mean, this group will share. You can learn. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing to do, and that's what I would suggest everybody do.
I learned more law being on that committee. You know, they said, oh, you all did a good job and you turned out something wonderful, and I think we did. But I got more out of being on that committee than I think I contributed, because I learned more law listening to the people discuss the points of law and discuss things that maybe I never had thought about. And I thought that I owe the state bar, I owe the family law section way more than I can ever repay.
I think the most important thing is the relationships. I think that the relationships that we have created and nurtured and maintained with one another, the men and the women, the lawyers and the judges in the family law area of practice, is second to none. There's a subtle but strong bond there between us. There's the networking. There's the knowledge that we have enriched the practice and made it a better practice for clients and the courts, that we take a lot of pride in it. I don't think there's any friend that I've had the privilege of making in the family law area that wouldn't do anything in the world for me within reason. A lot of them would do anything in the world whether there was reason to it or not, and I would do the same for them.
Bill Coons, legendary family lawyer, is the one who always said, all my friends are lawyers and all my best friends are family lawyers. And I never heard truer words spoken in my life. And that's how I think all successful family lawyers feel, because we're a collegial group, we're an intellectual group, we like to have spirited debates about anything, and it really, really makes it a great way to make a living, because if you're happy what you're doing, you're going to be successful at it.
Well, you'll never know if you like family law or are a good family lawyer until you try it. It's very hands-on. That's very intense at times, and you have a one-to-one relationship with your client, which is not true in large civil litigation, and it's not true in insurance defense. It's really not even true in plaintiff's defense, in my opinion, and it's certainly not true in appellate practice, tax law, bankruptcy, and things of that nature. So if you like people, you might like being a family lawyer, because you're definitely involved in people.
There are those that say that criminal law is the worst people at their best and family law is the best people at their worst. You've got to take the issues, the emotions, the problems, And you've got to figure out a way to resolve those problems. And sometimes you just can't. And sometimes people hate you because you didn't. And they revile you because you were aggressive in trying to do what you believed was the right thing.
The ability to help somebody who is emotionally distraught, emotionally upset about their children, about the failure in life that they see divorce means, and their loss of the expectation of happiness and the expectation of a positive relationship, to help them put this in the context of reality, to put it in the context of it's not the end of the world, and how they can survive through it or helping them get through it, I think is very personally very beneficial. And I'm not a shrink, and that's not what we do, but often we bring a lot of help to people, and I've read some things about people saying that they get more help from talking to a lawyer than they do talking to psychologists to some extent about these issues.
I've always likened the practice to being an emergency room nurse. First of all, if the blood bothers you, get the hell out. But you don't need to be there holding hands and weeping with the family and doing all that. You need to be saving their damn life. And lawyers, new lawyers coming into the practice, I think, need to understand that this is a job we're doing. It's a service we're providing. And if we let ourselves get caught up in the emotion, you're compounding the problem, not solving the problem typically.
Because if you get so involved, and it's almost impossible not to be involved with your individual clients and their concerns and their lives, and it's just it takes a tremendous emotional toll. So there was a point in time, and I don't remember which, but there was a point in time when I started telling myself, a family lawyer is not what I am, that's just what I do. And that seemed to work for a while, but I've come back around to, like it or not, it's what I am, not what I do. And if a lawyer's not willing to understand that that's a tension they're going to have throughout their professional life, I would tell them you probably ought not to get involved in this, because it's not the sort of thing you can pick up and put down.
It is a challenging practice, and anyone listening to this interview is probably chuckling when I say that. It's a challenging practice. It requires a lot of effort. It requires a lot of knowledge, and it requires, perhaps even more important than any of those things, a lot of patience to do it successfully. You have in the family law practice, you put up with a lot of different things that can literally drive you to distraction. You can have unreasonable clients, you can be dealing with unreasonable lawyers, you can be dealing with indifferent judges. All of those frustrate you, and you've got to learn to deal with that frustration, and you've got to be willing to deal with it in a manner that is professional and as much as possible courteous. It's a tough practice, but it is an extremely rewarding practice in terms of your personal goals and personal achievement. I can't think of an area of practice I'd rather engage in.
If you want to get into this area, be sure it's something that you love to do. If you have any regrets, reticence, reservations, anything that makes you feel in your heart that you don't love to do it, don't do it. Because if you love to do it, it will be fun, it will be rewarding, you can make some good money doing it. But if you don't like doing it, it can be your worst nightmare. Because, you know, with all the emotion, I tell people that's where Einstein came up with E equals MC squared is emotion, and family law equals MC squared, because, you know, all the stories are basically the same. There's unrest, upheaval, and what have you. And it's just through the last 40, 50 years, it's just the zeros have changed. But the stories are still the same.
One in particular, a lady, husband had left her, had a child who was 7 years old, and she worked. And I said, well, who watches your child during the day? He said, well, he goes to school. And I said, well, what about when he gets home? She said, I work. I got to work at 10 o'clock, and I get home at 7 o'clock in the morning so I can be with him. She didn't complain about not having anything. All she wanted was some child support and wanted him to stay away. That makes you feel good.
The one case that really sort of impacted who I am, and I've told people this before, I got a phone call from, in the 80s, from the Houston Volunteer Lawyers Program. It's a new project. They represented people who qualified for legal assistance and couldn't afford it. And the person that I was asked to represent was a person who was HIV positive with AIDS. And all he wanted was to have visitation with his two kids. That was at a time when there was a lot of prejudice about people with AIDS, even to the point that when he would come and sit in my office, and when he would leave, my secretary would go clean his chair. And I had to talk to her about the fact that you're not going to catch anything from him, and no, don't do that any longer, okay? We ended up trying the case. We ended up educating the judge with a doctor from the medical center who came down free of charge to educate the judge about any seriousness or concerns that he might have about AIDS. At the end of that trial, my client got visitation. A month later, he died. What he did get was two visitations with his children, and that was important.
I will tell you, the ones that stand out are the ones where you're kind of the underdog and you really don't have a chance and there's not a whole lot of money, but some jury does the right thing. Those are the ones that keep you going.
It was just incredible. Wednesday morning, I did local TV on Tuesday night and on Wednesday morning at 5 in the morning. And before I ever got out there, I'd been on CNN and on Headline News talking to, well, I was on Larry King one night, and you know, they would say, well, you know, can you get these lawyers? You know, who's going to represent them? And I said, yeah, they'll be there. And the national news media, of course, was very skeptical that this was going to happen, that lawyers would never go out and give their time away. And I said, you don't understand. This is what these people do every day. And so they were all blown away, frankly. And the line, you know, was around the block at the courthouse Wednesday morning. They all showed up. And the largest custody case in the world, 300 helpless children, and these people go out there on their own dime. You can give CPS all the criticism that you like, and a lot of people have heaped a lot of them on them, but there were some cases where kids didn't go back ultimately, two or three, and there have been convictions, and they're ongoing today, and the men out there at that place are going to prison for the things that they were doing. So as it turns out, there were people who were being abused and molested and assaulted, sexually assaulted, and ultimately the right thing happened, I think. But it happened because the lawyers went there and did their job.
And any doubt in your mind they'd do it again?
None. We could make those calls, and we could have 1,000 of them in the most remote place you wanted. I'm convinced.
I have some, but I don't want to tell them.
Well, tell about one of your best trials.
I'll tell you in the Childs case. Earl was on the other side. I represented Jerry Childs. He represented Patty Childs. And we both came from a tort background. That's when the intentional infliction of emotional distress was being tried. And we tried that thing, just knock down, drag out. And my client was a very wealthy guy. And we tried it to the jury, and we had to submit this intentional infliction of emotional distress to the jury. And while the jury is deliberating, Earl said, let's have a bet on what we think the verdict's going to be, and the winner, the loser has to buy the other one's dinner. And so he said, you write down a number on the piece of paper, I'll write down a number on the piece of paper, we'll put it in an envelope, we'll let the judge hold it, and the winner, the other one buys dinner. So I wrote my number down, Earl wrote his number down, and when the jury verdict came back, it was $500,000, and I said, well, you owe me dinner. He said, no. He said, you owe me dinner. I said, no, you owe me dinner. And he said, let me just tell you how I know you owe me dinner. He said, the number I wrote down was $500,000. I said, well, I'll tell you why I thought you owe me dinner. That's the number I wrote down.
Oh, my.
So I wrote down the number, Earl wrote down the number, and it was the same number that the jury came back with.
My client, his name was Alan Berry, he's deceased some time now. He'd had it would be the equivalent of a modern art Cuisinart, or modern day Cuisinart, that had been given to him at Christmas time from the Cherry Rivet Pop-Up Company. They made some kind of explosive rivets that you put in planes of airplanes, and they'd given him this blender. Well, she wouldn't let him have it. He said it was his separate property. We settled all the rest of the case, and Joe said, let's just go get him one, we'll buy it. So I went and picked him up, and he was in the 27th floor of the bank building, and picked him up, got in my car, and you didn't have Best Buy and Circuit City. You didn't even have Walmart in Fort Worth in those days. We spent about half a day looking for one of these things. We couldn't find anything that would match it. He had the model number, the brochure on it he'd gotten from his client, and we're driving back into downtown Fort Worth, going up Cherry Street, and he said, wait, stop in here. It's a place, it's 501 Cherry Street, called Nathan Frankel Electric Supply. And we went in there, and this thing was a Newtone brand, and they carried Newtone. We got the model number, but it was like 1 year newer. It was a most beautiful white and stainless steel. We got all the extra attachments that I wasn't sure if it had come with the original one. We bought it, and I drove, let Joe off at his offices, and I drove out North Main to Mr. Berry's offices, and I walked in there, and I waited till the receptionist would walk me into this hexagonal area where the offices were, and I told him what I'd done. I put it on the desk. He opened the box up, and he says, mine's avocado. And that's when I decided, you know, I ought not be fighting over pots and pans. And so I tried to avoid that type of thing, but it seems like none of us in this business can break the habit.
Had a case. We tried everything. Tried the kids. We kept telling the judge we had the property resolved. We thought we did. Everything was over. These two people are now fighting about two items of property, and one of them's an armoire, and one of them's a something else. So we go back down there very sheepishly, and we have this trial set. We've got to talk to Theo about it. And she says, all right, so we've got our clients, and we start putting on testimony. And I mean, it's just embarrassing. But here we are. So we're putting on the testimony. We get about 15 minutes into it, and you hear her up there tearing a piece of paper, and then she writes a minute, and then she's crumpling. The way the benches are set up, we can't see her hands or what she's doing. She said, all right, I've had enough. And she reaches over like this, drops two little balls of wadded up paper, one in front of each client. I said, I don't know which one's which, but the one in front of you is what you got. And that was it. Trial over.
That was the end of the trial.
I had to try a case in Carrizo Springs against the legendary trial lawyer Jim Stewart from San Antonio, one of my best friends, has been and still is, and a wonderful mentor. He was at it when I came from Southeast Asia in a military uniform and changed to coat and tie and tried to find the Bexar County Courthouse. Jim Stewart was practicing family law then. But he and I had a black bear custody case in Carrizo Springs. This old rancher, this old wealthy rancher, who of course Jim represented, and I represented the younger lady without any money that had married him, that didn't last a long time. The old rancher was a little too crusty for her, and she wanted to go back to San Antonio and go back to school. Well, he had given her as a gift two baby orphan black bears that were freshly born. They lived out on a huge ranch outside of Carrizo Springs, and she even had little scratch marks on her arms where she was feeding those baby bears bottles. They would scratch, and this was a beautiful young lady and crusty old husband rancher. Well, these bears were grown. Two grown back black bears that lived behind the house in pens and stuff, and they were her babies, and he didn't like them. And she wanted custody of those, and he was just laughing at her. He wanted to kick her butt out of Carrizo Springs and send her back to San Antonio at minimum expense and get on with his life. Like, she was a pain for him. But those were her babies, and she knew he'd kill them. And we could resolve everything, dollars, property, everything in the world, but those black bears were a real problem. And so Jim and I got together and tried, I mean, it was almost, he almost couldn't resolve it because he didn't like them and she loved them, but he was the only place, and the ranch was his separate property and all of that. So we met down there at some office in Carrizo Springs, and she insisted upon going out and seeing her babies because he had not let her see them. And so I talked Jimmy into it, and I had a pilot back then who was about like Barney Fife. He was a real skinny, high-strung guy, and I had my young lady. We'd all flown down from San Antonio and landed on the little dirt airstrip down there, and they'd met us and taken us to an office there. And so we all went out to the ranch, and Jimmy and his client were in one car, and they loaned us another car. I don't even know what it was, but somebody else's car. And we drove out to the ranch, and Jimmy and his client got out and went to the back of the house hurriedly in front of us. And my client said, come on, let's go see my babies. And so we started out there behind them, and she was ahead of me, and I was next to her, and my little pilot was behind me. And we rounded that corner, and I saw Jim and his client over by the porch behind a brick wall kind of grinning. And I looked over there and I thought, what in the hell is going on? And I looked, and the cage, the big chain link fence cage in this huge cage was open. And there was a house in there, and there were two big black heads sticking out. And my little client, who was about 5'4 and weighed about 100 pounds soaking wet, said, babies, babies, and put her arms out. And about this time, you heard these roars, and out came a male and female, brother and sister black bear, that one weighed about 600 and the other one weighed about 400. And they came out that door and headed right for us, full speed, out in this open back area behind this ranch house. And I heard this noise behind me, and I looked, and my pilot had turned and was just running back to the truck in the front of the house as fast as he could. And I looked over at Stuart and his client, and they were laughing their asses off. And I looked at my little lady, and she was holding her hands out, and here's macho John Wayne Compeer that's thinking, now wait a minute, I can't run. That would be cowardly, and I'm damn sure not going to run with Stuart and his client looking at me. I've got to be real courageous and brave, but what the hell am I going to do if these black bears kill me and eat me, and the San Antonio paper says local lawyer killed and eaten by two black bears in Carrizo Springs? But I'm trying to intellectually resolve this dilemma. These bears run up to her, and she runs to them, and she just slaps them, and they fall down on the ground, and they're rolling around, and she's slapping them, and they're slapping her, and they got massive hands, and one of them is putting his mouth over her arm, and she's loving them and playing with them, and they're just rolling around and having a great time. So I thought, oh, this is pretty neat. So I start to walk up there, and about the time the big male sees me, and he turns loose and raises up and goes, ah. And I thought, nope, better not do this. So I turned and went over with Stuart and his client and sat there while she played with those damn huge bears. And I told Stuart, I'm going to remember this, buddy. You're going to owe me for that one. And he loved it. He thought that was the greatest thing. He's told that forever. But we did work it out, and she got to go down every other weekend and stay in a place in Carrizo and drive out there and play with her bears. And they had a swimming pool and everything. And he agreed to not shoot them with a pellet gun and not kill them or hurt them. And as far as I know, they're still, I'm sure they're dead by now, but she went and visited, told me she saw them all the time and kept them until the zoo got them or they died of old age. But that's my bear war story, a custody case with bears.
I was questioning her. I said, isn't it true that you took these children I started through since they were knee-high to a to a duck. And, you know, did this. Well, when Oliver got up, he he got to that point. He says, remember when Mr. Stewart asked you the question on the children whether taking them since they were knee-high to a grasshopper, and I hit the table like that, I popped out of my seat. I said, Your Honor, I object. He is purposely and intentionally misrepresenting my statement. And the jury there like this, and because I said knee-high to a duck, not knee-high to a grasshopper. And everybody just busted out laughing.
This wasn't a family law case.
Okay.
And this happened probably in about 1974 or 5. No, it was 1974. In those days, the district attorney's office was prosecuting what they called pornographic film industry. And Deep Throat came to town. And the poor projectionist was prosecuted. He was arrested, and so he was prosecuted. It was not my case. There's a fellow in San Antonio named Jerry Goldstein, who was then a young, rising criminal defense lawyer. And he was a friend of my partner at the time, Bob Price. And Jerry said, this is so bad. I need a young woman to sit as co-counsel with me because this jury is going to be so off-putted by by what they're going to see. So he said, I'm not trying to do this chauvinistically, but I need a young lawyer here, a woman. And I was 24 years old at the time, or 25 maybe. And he said, will you do it? I said, okay, as long as you promise me that you will keep my name out of the paper. And I knew the TV station was going to cover this because I knew that my parents were both still living then and would not have approved. So he made that promise to me. And the funny part about the case is my job was to, in those days, of course, it was 8mm films, mm-hmm. and we had a number of experts who were going to render their expert opinion that the material did not offend the public sensitivity. So I personally have seen the film Deep Throat about 30 times because it was my job to sit in the office to make sure that all of these experts saw the film and were able to pick out pieces that they thought might need comment. So that's my claim to fame.
I'm so glad I asked that question.
Danny was driven to make family lawyers better family lawyers. He did so much for the State Bar, and he did so much for us. As you will recall, his papers on discovery were second to none anywhere, usually 165 pages. And if you couldn't find your answer in one of Danny's papers, there was not an answer to be found. But extremely devoted man, and he wanted everything to be the best. And he is dearly, dearly missed.
Well, he was a brilliant lawyer. That's you know, if you had to say something about Dan Price in just 4 or 5 or 6 words, that would be it. He was a brilliant lawyer.
Danny Price was a personal friend. We didn't always agree on things. Richard Orsinger, Dan Price, and I had a overnight argument about discovery at one advanced family law course that we had to quit the argument because Richard had to give a speech that morning. But Danny was always a person who was always trying to think and to create better tools for representing people.
All of those qualities together, he was a good friend. He was always respectful, even when he disagreed with people. He was committed to his clients. He undertook jobs that required a lot of dedication and sacrifice. I think that is the reason why he was so well thought of. And then when he died prematurely and surprised all of us, and we all missed him so much.
Dan died the year that he was to be course director of the advanced family law course, and it was still completed under his name as course director. If you go back and look at the red books from those days, the course books, they bear his name as course director. And that year, we initiated the Dan Price Award. And the concept of that award was that it was to recognize attorneys who in the prior year had made substantial contributions to family law, family lawyers, and their clients.
I was speechless to receive that type of recognition. One being as close a friend to Dan as I was, and then secondly, to receive that recognition when I knew that there were very deserving people in the practice of family law, that I received it before them. That made a big impact on my life. And I will tell you that award, which is a little glass piece of paper, sits on my desk. It looks at me. It doesn't look at my clients. It looks at me to remind me what that obligation means to receive that award.
He was a man that was a district judge that treated all of us as if we were equal in every way. And one of his lessons for me, and I think for others, was to do the same to everyone else. Be them a young lawyer, an old lawyer, a judge, a professor, a client. He was one of those rare individuals that truly cared about people and about us as lawyers trying to help people.
Sam was kind of a one-of-a-kind judge. Knew Sam from about 1977, I guess, until his untimely death in 83. And as one may not know, if you've just practiced for a few years, there were very few judges that you could try a bench trial on a custody case where you represented a dad. Sam was one of them.
You know, Sam was a remarkable person on many levels, but he was in another way just one of us. He was just another hardworking, good lawyer, and he would be the first one to be embarrassed about all the fuss we make over the Sam Emerson Award.
I don't mean this in a bad way, but Sam Emerson looked like he came in from underneath the overpass. He was not a fashion plate. He didn't worry about how he dressed. But he had the ability to cut through all of the BS and get right down to the issue and come up with a solution to a problem. He could get from point A to point B in a straight line.
Sam was so smart that it was tough for him to be on the bench, and he wanted to debate the law with you. And so I would, whenever I was in the court with Sam, I would argue this point or that point, and regardless of the quality of my opposing counsel, Sam would want to get right in the middle of it and start arguing the law with me and start asking questions. And finally, I said, wait a minute, Judge. He said, oh, yeah, I'm the judge. And but Sam always was fair, honest. I mean, he was a great judge.
Sam was just the most unassuming, brightest guy I've ever seen. I remember when he died, unfortunately, in an accident, and I got word, I was just totally crushed, and I went down to his funeral, and place was just mobbed. I remember it was raining and thundering, very sad day. And at the end of the eulogies and all, Don Royal stood and said, you know, I've heard all everybody's got to say, and I'm in total agreement, says, but you know what I'd like to do, and I think what Sam would enjoy? Said, I'd like to give him a hand. And I don't know, oh gosh, there had to be 1,500 people there, I guess. We all stood and gave Sam a hand. He was an inspiration, bright guy.
Well, that had to be receiving the Sam Emerson Award. in 2004. It was total shock and surprise, and still can't believe it to this day. Being recognized by lawyers, but especially family lawyers, means very, very much to me, and it's a moment I'll never forget.
The best moment for me, frankly, was the night of the Emerson Award. Still chokes me up. Don't know how I got it. Don't know how I got on the list. Damn glad I got it. You can't have it back. And that was as proud a moment as I've had in the practice.
I believe that the Hall of Legends came into being about 15 years ago. And frankly, it was a council project that there were an awful lot of folks that had an awful lot to do with where we are in family law today. We talked earlier about the first family code in 1974, which I believe was about 32 pages. It was almost a pamphlet.
Right.
And for people to get a full appreciation of the Ken Fullers, the Bill Coots, the Scotty Cooks, the Don Fullenwiders, that it was extremely important from not only a historical backdrop, but basically to kind of see where we came from. And we've come a long way. And it was a tribute to those folks who have practiced law for 40 plus years, devoted primarily to the family law area. And it is a difficult club to get into, if you will. Just because you practice 40 years doesn't automatically grant you admission into that exclusive club. But I think that's extremely important for young lawyers to have some historical ground, so to speak, as to where all this stuff started way back when.
You look at the people that are on that wall, and I am just terribly honored to be up there with them, and I couldn't hold their hat. They're good folks, and they're outstanding lawyers, truly are.
I have always been proud of the fact that I have a law license. And I never sought to have a law. I didn't know I was going to be a lawyer. Never met a lawyer in my life until I was in law school. I had none in my family. I was studying journalism at the University of Houston, and I got very discouraged about it. I'm not a good speller. I wasn't a great writer, and I thought they were all cynical. And a psychology professor there, who later became a very good friend, was teaching me a class, and he was head of the guidance section. So I told him I was going to drop out of school and try something else, and he said, "Oh, don't do that. Come see me." And so he ran me through these tests and said, "Have you ever thought about law school?" I said, "No." And he said, "Well, you ought to try it. You'd like it." So he talked to the dean, and it was easier then because he had run me through all these tests. I don't know what they were, but I took tests for a week, and had all these graduate students working on me, tell me what I should do. And so I entered law school. He said, "I would arrange for you to go to law school. You're already ahead of enough hours. You're ahead of yourself." And so I entered law school at the middle of my junior year in college on a combination degree plan. And he said, "We'll fix it. If you don't like it, drop out. You haven't lost it but a semester." So I entered law school and just loved it. And at the end of, I finished undergraduate in law school in 5 years, which I regret now because I missed a lot of the undergraduate work, and I was a law clerk the last 2 years. So, but this is the fact that I got that law license. It just was the greatest honor that I thought I ever could have, and I thought I got to live up to what this means and what the history of the profession is and what it can do. And so giving back to the profession, working, doing my pro bono work, my giving back kind of responsibility has always been to the profession. And if I've made it one inch better, I would be very proud of that as my legacy.
Your integrity is more important than anything. It is more important than any case or any number of cases. And that never let anyone talk you into doing anything where anyone could question your integrity, your honesty, and in dealing with clients or in dealing with the other attorneys?
We're professionals. We should act like professionals. We should wear a suit, not to see how trashy we are with blue jeans and an open shirt when you're meeting with clients. That loses the R. And I was shocked the first time I went to a deposition and the opposing attorney came in a sports shirt. I was just shocked. Now it's accepted and it's lowering our standard. And the other thing I tell these young, any young lawyers, is it takes years and years to build a reputation. And then you pull one shyster dirty trick and you get stamped across the forehead. You know, what you are and your reputation goes to hell in a handbasket.
I remember telling my son when he started practicing law, and I'm quite proud of him and what he's made of himself, but I remember telling him when he started, first got his law practice, that I could forgive him anything except sully our name. And I know other lawyers who felt the same way. They'd worked so damn hard to get a good name and make a reputation that you tell people the truth. It's just that simple. You just tell them the truth. And you didn't switch pages out of their out of a proposed judgment that had been come, or change the tense of a verb or things like that. You need to represent your client with zest and vigor and the utmost integrity.
Well, I have a son who's a lawyer, a new lawyer, and I don't think he's going to be a family lawyer, but he's a litigator, and he deals with now mostly a plaintiff's practice. And what I've instilled in him is to be honest and respectful to his staff and to courts and to his clients. I think that's the most important thing that you can do. You have to be respectful of people and treat other people well. It sounds so simple, but I sit sometimes in judges' offices and I can overhear lawyers screaming at court coordinators about things, and I go, really? How do you think you're ever going to get a setting? And my father was instrumental in that with me, and he said, you know, you need to learn who the clerks are and who the coordinators are, and they need to be your friends. And I tell you, I've had cases where I was missed a deadline and called a clerk up in Wise County, 45 miles from where I live, and said, man, I'm in so much trouble, I needed to file this. And she said, well, just eat dinner and meet me up at the courthouse tonight, and I'll file that for you, you know, 9 o'clock at night. You know, that doesn't happen when you cuss people out and you are not civil. But I think that, and that's one of the biggest problems, both in politics and at law and at the courthouse, is the real lack of civility that you see now. And we need to return to a day when, it's a sexist expression, but when there were gentlemen lawyers and you could trust what people said.
One golden rule, and don't ever deviate from it. And that's when you shake hands with somebody on something, have it mean something. Have your handshake mean something. Because as you know, there are lawyers in our business, you can shake hands with them, you can take that to the bank, you don't have to worry about them backing up on anything. And the lawyers that I know and trust are the lawyers who shake hands with me, and I know that they mean it.
Act a lot better than your clients, dress a lot better than your clients. Understand that by acting and dressing appropriately, you're showing respect to the court and respect to our legal system. And understand that, yes, we all get a little frustrated. Yes, we all get a little agitated by the other side. But it is important to our practice, if we're going to continue to have a profession, that we act civilly and we act professionally. I can tell you, going home at night, when I'm dealing with somebody who is acting civilly and professionally, it's a lot easier to go home and work with my dog than when I have to deal with somebody who is what we used to call a Rambo lawyer and goes out of their way to make things difficult for you when they don't need to.
But you better remember one thing if you don't remember anything else. Probably 6 to 9 months after you finish a hard-fought divorce case, most of your clients are going to either think you charged them too much, you took too long to get it done, or you didn't get a good enough result. But the thing you need to remember is that the rest of your professional life, you're going to be working with, for, or against that lawyer on the other side and the judges that you're dealing with. So you better know this. Those are the ones you're going to stay in contact with the next 30, 40 years. They're the ones that are going to be putting bread on your table. They're the ones going to be referring your cases. They're the ones going to be deciding what your attorney's fees are. They're going to ones going to decide whether or not you get your case passed or have to go to trial, have prepared or not. And bear in mind who they are. These are the people you're going to be working with the rest of your life. And to get in there and make an ass out of yourself and start backbiting just because your client wants you to hate the other person, and remember this, they'd both buy and sell you in a minute. They'd both throw you right under the bus and then try to direct another one on you. So you're going to be working with these people, and treat them in a professional way. You'll be rewarded. I promise you, you will. They'll be your friends. They'll send you business. They'll make your life a lot easier when you're dealing with them on the other side. And you won't have any problem looking in that mirror next morning shaving your face.
We've done a lot of great innovations over the years. I mean, the things that we have taken the section from where it was to where it is now, where we have our own publications, we have our own clothing line, if you will, we have CLE opportunities that are unbelievable. We have great pro bono projects that we're having like 6 pro bono seminars a year now, and all the lawyers that it takes to volunteer their time and their talent to go and do those things. I think the crowning thing is to be part of that organization that would spread, if you will, the gospel of professional family law practice throughout our state. I know that being in the American Academy of Matrimonial Lawyers, for example, on a national basis, I've brought people, as others have brought people from that organization and others, to the CLE in Texas, because it's really hard when you're talking to these lawyers, family lawyers from other areas. They can't imagine that we're telling the truth. They assume it's some Texas bragging, you know, when we say, well, advanced family law, we have 1,800 to 2,000 lawyers show up for a 4-day course. They just can't believe that. And so it's really rewarding to bring them and to let them experience it. And without a doubt, because of the family law section and the State Bar of Texas, we have the absolute best family law CLE in the world, bar none. And I just think that's a credit to the section and to everybody that had anything to do with the section.
Our CLE is well known throughout the world as the best in the world, period. It is not even debated. What we have seen is representatives from all over the country and from other countries come and observe our advanced course and other courses to learn how to improve their own CLE.
As we begin to grow, I think we became very innovative. We probably were the first large seminar that went to TVs, so that now you can sit in your room in house slippers and rollers and watch the CLE events. I know we were the first that went to panels. Richard Orsinger was very creative in saying, one day we're going to have breakout sessions. And everybody said, that's just crazy, we're not going to do that. But it worked, and it's something that people look forward to now. And I think it has been very, very important to, one, our understanding of the law and educating people that don't always have an opportunity to deal with all the cases that some of us deal with, but at least educate them on some how that case may help, or how their case may be helped by some of these nuances in the law. I think the second thing is, and I've spoken at other states, it is impressive to me that you have 50, 100 lawyers donating their time at one of these programs, and all the time before they got here writing doing PowerPoints and discussing panels that don't get compensated. People in California, people in other states, they pay lawyers who get paid to talk of those speeches. And we donate it all. And I think that in and of itself, as well as how we've expanded some of the ideas of the seminars. We're not just advanced family law. You know, the first advanced family law, I think they had it at St. Mary's. They lived in the dorm. My first advanced family law was at La Monsignor del Norte. We went back to our rooms and read the outlines. So we came down the next day with outlines all highlighted. And I mean, now, you know, I don't know if anybody reads the outlines until the program's being presented, but it was a very serious study attempt. But we've added things like Ultimate Trial Notebook, the legislative changes and forms. We've added seminars on new frontiers of family law, just thinking outside the box and things like that. That's been very impressive.
The New Frontiers course, to me, was just a wonderful development for lawyers who had a little bit of expertise to kick around those problems that didn't have answers. And when I started, we didn't have that. And for a lawyer not to take advantage of those things is a big, big mistake. And for a lawyer not involved with the state bar projects, the seminars, the drafting of books and things like that, I think it's a big mistake because you learn more than you give.
I think all of us look forward to the Advanced Family Law course. And other courses have their own following, but to me the Advanced Family Law course is the 1600. The year I was a course director in 1987, there were 1100 people. Now they're getting up to 1600, 1700, 1800. And it's a lot of fun. You see people that you haven't seen in 6 months or a year, you hear them up on the stage, you meet judges. It's so different. I mean, you cannot understand. It's like truly sitting in a classroom for maybe the 1977 Advanced Family Law course was like sitting in a law school classroom. Coming here now is like going to Disneyland. So it's so different. And the quality of the learning is great too. We have big panels now and we have parallel discussions. So if you're not interested in that topic, you got one or two other topics you can talk to. It's great. You know, if we all drift off into just our computers and learning from our computers and relating to each other through emails, you get very isolated. And one of the things that I really enjoy about the practice of family law is that the family lawyers are always in touch with each other, both in the courtroom, in the hallways, and even outside of the courthouse altogether. The family law educational experience through continuing legal education is social as well as intellectual. And the social part of it is maybe as important as the intellectual part of it. And I'm a great believer in coming to these live courses where you can see lawyers from all over the state and have drinks with them if you still drink, or have meals with them if you don't, and listen to their experiences and meet judges from different cities. And to me, that connection that we maintain, which you can only get by being in person, I think it's important, and it's an important feature. It's an add-on to coming to a course and hearing about the law and hearing about the latest cases and hearing good practitioners tell you how to do things. But just meeting and talking and seeing each other is an important part, I think, of staying in touch.
In 1973, there was a person that took time to help me. In 1995, there was a person that took time to help me. In 2010, I try to take time to help somebody, to teach somebody. We have it at our firm. We have kind of a joke. Some of the younger lawyers will walk in and say, hey, can school be in? And I said, you bet, school's in. And they'll ask me something. And it's just really rewarding to tell them what I think about something. Well, that's part of the whole thing that we're here about today. about this convention that's here and about what we're going to do in August when we all get together again. It's people getting together and talking about things that are important in family law. We have to not be reliant upon our legislature to tell us every single specific thing about family law. We need to have our, use our imagination. We need to read cases. We need to talk to our friends and colleagues. We need to think about imaginative ways to solve issues, problems, to help people, to help families, to do those things so that we can all get better at what we do.
You can be competent in the practice of law if you attend those seminars, but I don't think you can be totally competent in the practice of family law if you don't. When you have people like Warren Cole, yourself, other people, Jack Maher, giving their experience, their knowledge, you can't miss that. You have to have that. You can't practice law without the Family Law Practice Manual, in my opinion. I don't know how somebody does that. When young lawyers come to me, they'll ask me questions, and I'll tell them, you know, invest in the Family Law Practice Manual, invest in the CLE of the State Bar, and you'll be a much better lawyer. And don't think it's a waste of money, because it's not. And that's where your first investment ought to be if that's your direction.
I have to steal this phrase from Jimmy Brill, who's a 50-year lawyer that does primarily guardianship and probate stuff. But I think if we could leave, he said, if I have helped one lawyer be a better lawyer, my role has been fulfilled. And I think that it's really, really important with some of us gray-haired folks to not only instill some of the ethical stuff that we've grown up with, but also to make them be better lawyers. I think we've got a responsibility in that respect.
It's very rewarding. Nobody gets paid to do that. You're going to spend countless hours doing it, and you wonder, well, why would you want to do that? Well, the benefits are multifaceted. One, it's really fun, and you will make some friendships that you would never make before. And you'll have a great time. Plus, I think all lawyers are professionals. I think our profession strives to be professional, and you're going to give back something. I've gotten a lot from this family law practice. It's made me live an enjoyable, rich, and full life, and it's time to give back. And I don't think any lawyer, certainly not myself, who's been so fortunate to have this kind of a practice and this kind of a life would do anything but give back. It's really fun to teach. It's fun to mentor people, help somebody out, explain something they don't know, tell them, well, I don't know if this is the right way, but this is how I did it. I just think that's part of being a professional. I think, again, I go back to the hallmark, I think, of what we do. Our business is about helping others, whether that be a client or whether that be a fellow lawyer. You know, if it's a fellow lawyer and I can help them, great. You know what? They're going to help me someday. There's not any question about it. I'm going to need their help, and they're going to be willing to help me because I help them. And I think that's what it's all about, giving back and helping others. And I think that's what we do when boiled down to a real simple, simplistic two-sentence words. I think that's what we do.
The people that are following us that may see this someday when they have nothing in the world to do but look at the oldest lawyers on the planet talking about things and back in the day, I'll tell you, there have been a lot of people that preceded me who spent time in the trenches being in Austin lobbying, being before an audience, spending 100 hours writing an article so that you could spend 20 minutes trying to tell somebody a point or a secret that you've got about practicing law. All those things are why the family law section is what it is today, and why 25 years from now, people are going to look back and say, gosh, those people were in the Stone Age when they start talking about what we're doing. It's the family of